You must remember that the governors wanted to have total control over the opening of their states, but now they want to have us, the federal government, do the testing. And again, testing is local. You can't have it both ways. Testing is a local thing, and it's very important. It's great, but it's a local thing, and we're going to get it done to a level in a very short period of time, because all of the swabs are coming in, all of the necessary materials, a lot of them, as I said, are already there, but a lot of people don't know that yet.
The president claiming that this testing is a local thing, dodging responsibility for that and other things. But it was just last month that he falsely insisted that anybody that needs a test gets a test.
Yeah, the president really has tried to have it both ways on this testing issue, Don, particularly as it relates to what the federal government is responsible for and what the localities and the states are responsible for. We've seen the president and his administration come out to that very same briefing room podium that we saw today and tout the number of tests that they've been able to ramp up capacity across the country. And yet at the same time, we've also seen the president pass the buck over to governors of states and saying it's their job to do the testing. Testing's a local thing. Now, we did hear a little bit more about what the federal government is going to do to help some of these governors, and that is the president said that he's going to be invoking the Defense Production Act to ramp up production of some of those testing swabs. But at the same time, we also saw the president suggest that these governors simply are unwilling or unable to do what they need to do to ramp up testing, saying that it's their fault. So there is a little bit of a disconnect here, Don, it seems, between what the president sees as the governor's responsibility and what the federal government is actually working to do to try and ramp up testing capacity. But nonetheless, it is very clear, Don, that the president and his administration do not see ramping up testing from now going into the future as the federal government responsibility.
Okay, so Jeremy, another odd moment at the briefing, in the briefing room last week, it was this propaganda video, the president playing, self-congratulatory clips last week in this video, mostly from conservative media and Fox News. This one was a self-congratulatory clips from the New York governor, Andrew Cuomo. Again, an odd moment in the briefing room. I want to play this part of your exchange as well about the clip that he played, and then we'll talk about it. Here he is.
More than 22 million Americans are currently unemployed as a result of this. Today we hit the grim milestone of more than 40,000 Americans now having died from the coronavirus. Can you explain then why you come out here and you are reading clips and showing clips of praise for you and for your administration? Is this really the time for self-congratulations?
Well, I will tell you this. What I'm doing is I'm standing up for the men and women that have done such an incredible job. Not for me, for the men and women, admirals, vice president, if I might, but all of the men and women, thousands, tens of thousands of them that built hospitals in New York and New Jersey and all over this country in record time, that throw up 1,000 beds in 4 days. I'm sticking up for those people. Those people have been incredible. I'm also sticking up for doctors and nurses and military doctors and nurses.
The clips that you played and what you read earlier was praising you and your administration.
All I played today was Governor Cuomo
to do that, sir,
saying very positive things about the job the federal government has done. And those people,
40,000 Americans have now died.
And those people have been just absolutely excoriated by some of the fake news.
Jeremy, it seems like he is making your point because he played nothing about the people who are on the front lines. Everything he talked about was just him, and what a great job that he's doing. He's actually defending himself.
That's right. And that's why it kind of struck me as such a remarkable split screen moment. You know, Don, we have 22 million Americans who have had to file for unemployment as a result of this coronavirus crisis. We now have more than 41,000 Americans who have died of this coronavirus crisis. And yet I was sitting there in the briefing room watching the president talk about how wonderful everything is and how well his administration has done. There's a time for the president to perhaps tout the what his administration has done. And he can certainly make that case. That is his prerogative. But it just struck me as a pretty damning split screen to see the president saying that on the day where we have this grim milestone of more than 40,000 deaths. And it wasn't just, of course, the clip that he played from Governor Cuomo praising the federal government's response. It was also that he read a headline from an opinion piece in the Wall Street Journal. The headline is literally, "Trump rewrites the book on emergencies." And yet somehow the president was claiming that what he was reading was not about him, but about other people, about the hospital workers, about the doctors. That's clearly not what the president was focused on today.
Listen, Jeremy, make no mistake about it. These are my words. It's not yours, because you have to work at the White House every day and you have to work with these people. But does the president not understand that him coming out there every day and acting like a jerk is not going to help him with the American people? The American people are tired of it. It shows in the polling that people are watching every day because they want information about saving lives. They want to know where they are, when they can actually go back to work, and not about what a great job he's doing when everyone knows there's not enough testing. People don't want to go back to work if there's not enough testing. People are reticent to go back to work if there aren't tests, if they don't know if they have antibodies, if that's actually going to protect them from getting this virus. Is there a disconnect in the White House with this president? Does anybody talk to him about that? Does anyone have the courage to stand up to this person, to this bully, as we see him in this briefing room every day, to give him a real talk and say, hey, listen, you need to get out there and tell the American people the truth and stop acting like a big bully?
Look, here's what I can say, Don. The president is always going to lean back on his instincts as a salesman, right? That's what his whole career, his whole life, whether in business or on reality TV, like, that is what his life has been about, is about portraying things as better than they are, selling them as better than they are. So that is always the instinct that the president is going to fall back on. There are some officials at the White House who think that the president is doing himself a disservice by coming out and speaking so much. There's a lot of grumbling among some Republicans who wish that the president would perhaps allow the health experts to speak more. I mean, you had Admiral Brett Giroir, who is leading the effort on the testing front, which was the main topic at today's briefing, and he sat in that chair on the side of the briefing room throughout the entire news conference. And he did not come up to answer any questions. Mm-hmm. He wasn't asked by the president to make any remarks. So look, the president has always viewed himself as his best communicator. That is why we have seen the White House go through press secretaries and communications directors at a rapid rate, because the president will never allow anybody else to kind of lead that messaging aspect. The president always sees himself as best able to do that. And that's because, again, in 2016, the president proved other people wrong by talking the way that he did on the campaign trail.
I want to ask you as well, because we see these exchanges every day at the briefing. It has become, you know, everyday viewing to watch the president go off on reporters. But to watch him sit there and belittle, especially women, by telling them, he told Caitlin Collins, enough, last week, and he told this reporter today to, you know, lower your voice or what have you. But to sit there and to watch the president exhibit this sexist behavior that must be uncomfortable. It is uncomfortable for the people at home. What is it like sitting there in the briefing room and to watch this, to experience this behavior?
Look, none of us like to see the president belittle any of us or our colleagues who are, you know, just trying to ask the president questions. Weijia Jiang of CBS News did a phenomenal job tonight. She was simply asking the president about some of his past comments and some of his past actions. And that is simply what we all in the press corps are going to continue to do, is simply ask the president questions that are important, that people need to have answers to. And that is, I think, going to be our guiding mantra.
The president also talked, Jeremy, talked about the people protesting the stay-at-home orders. Watch this, please.
They've got cabin fever. They want to get back. They want their life back. Their life was taken away from them. And, you know, they learned a lot during this period. They learned to do things differently than they have in the past. And, you know, they'll do it hopefully until the virus has passed. And when the virus passes, I hope we're going to be sitting next to each other in baseball games, football games, basketball games, ice hockey games. I hope we're going to be sitting next to each other. I hope you have golf. The Masters is going to have 100,000 people, not 25 people watching.
He seems to be disconnected from the reality of the virus doesn't care how many people want sports back. Everybody wants sports back in business as usual. But he seems to want these protesters out there. And at one point he said that these protesters seem to be following the rules. Well, the rules are to stay at home. So they're disobeying the rules, yet he is championing for these reporters, it seems. And they are not socially distancing. All you have to do is pick up your phone or look at the images that are out there on the internet, and they are not following social distancing guidelines. They're not even following the rules that the president and the governors of their states have set.
Yeah, there really has been mixed messaging on this front from the president, Don, because we see the president on Thursday talking about these guidelines for reopening the country, talking about a gradual multi-phase process to allow businesses to reopen, to allow children to go back to school, certain criteria that they need to hit. And then the next day we see the president tweet this, you know, liberate Michigan, liberate Minnesota, liberate Virginia, states that have not yet hit the threshold for actually beginning to reopen in the way that the president's own guidelines envision this process happening. And I think one of the big factors why the president is backing these protests is, number one, he wants to be viewed as the person who wants to reopen the country, doesn't want to be viewed as responsible for the economic devastation that this virus has wrought. And the president also knows that the people who are out there protesting in large percentages are his own supporters. In fact, we've seen conservative groups organizing many of these protests in some of these different states. So anytime you have someone who likes the president, who's a supporter of the president, who's doing something, it's going to be very hard to get the president to say what they're doing is wrong.